Dear children, come back to online classes. Today we shall see chapter 2, that is understanding secularism. In previous chapter we have seen a secular state is one in which the state does not officially promote any one religion as the state religion. Now let us understand with some of the example given here. Imagine yourself as a Hindu or Muslim living in a part of the United States of America where Christian fundamentalism is very powerful. Suppose that despite being a US citizen, no one is willing to rent their house to you. How would this make you feel? Would it not make you feel resentful? Yes, you will feel angry. You will feel sad and you may take the view that there should be justice for all. You may fight stating that no one should be discriminated against on grounds of their religious practices and beliefs. So this statement rests on the assumption that all forms of domination related to religion should end. So in this chapter you are going to learn more about this. Here let us see history. In history provides us with many examples of discrimination, exclusion and persecution on the grounds of religion. Firstly, Jews were persecuted in Hitler's Germany. They were harassed by Hitler, and how several millions were killed. Now, however, the Jewish state of Israel treats its own Muslims and Christian minorities quite badly. Next, in Saudi Arabia, non-Muslims are not allowed to build a temple, church, etc., and nor can they gather in places, public places for prayer. In all the above examples, members of one religious community either persecute or discriminate against members of other religious communities. These acts of discrimination takes place more easily when one religion is given official recognition by the state at the expense of other religion. Clearly, no one would wish to be discriminated against because of their religion, not dominated by another religion. So in India, can the state discriminate against citizens or the grounds on the grounds of their religion? Let us see what is secularism. In the previous chapter we have already read about Indian constitution contains fundamental rights that protect us against state power as well as against the tyranny of the majority. So let me remind you some of the fundamental rights. Let me tell you what are fundamental rights. Fundamental rights has been often referred to as the conscience of the Indian constitution. Fundamental rights protect citizens against the arbitrary and absolute exercise of power by the state. The constitution thus guarantees the rights of individuals against the state as well as against other individuals. So let me tell you about the first right, right to equality. All persons are equal before law. Next is right to freedom. This includes the right to freedom of speech and expression, reside in any part of the country and practice any profession, occupation or business. Next is right against exploitation. The constitution prohibits human trafficking, forced labor and employment of children under 14 years of age.
Then next comes the right to freedom of religion. Right, religious freedom is provided to all citizens. Every person has the right to practice, profess and propagate the religion of their choice. Next is cultural and educational rights. The Constitution states that all minorities, religious or linguistic, can set up their own educational institution in order to preserve and develop their own culture. And the last was right to constitutional remedies. This allows citizens to move the court if they believe that any of their fundamental rights have been violated by the state. So, the Indian Constitution allows individuals the freedom to live by their religious beliefs and practices as they interpret this, as given in the fundamental rights. In keeping with this idea of religious freedom for all, India also adopted a strategy of separating the power of religion and the power of the state. So India, power of the state and power of the religion are separate. Secularism refers to this separation of religion from the state. So why is it important to separate religion from the state? As discussed above, the most important aspect of secularism is its separation of religion from state power. In a democratic country, it is important because almost all countries of the world will have more than one religion group living in them. Within these religious groups, there will most likely be one group that is in a majority. If this majority religious group has access to state power, then it could quite easily use this power and financial resources to discriminate against and persecute persons of other religions. So that is why it is important to separate religion from the state. This tyranny of the majority could result in the discrimination, coercion. Coercion here means force someone to do something, and at times even the killing of the religious minorities. The majority could quite easily prevent minorities from practicing their religion. Any form of domination based on religion is in violation of rights that a democratic society guarantees to each and every citizen irrespective of their religious. Here, minorities means less in number. Therefore, the tyranny of the majority and the violation of fundamental rights that can result in one reason why it is important to separate the state and religion in democratic societies. Another reason why it is important to separate religion from the state is democratic society, because we also need to protect the freedom of individual to exit from their religion, embrace another religion, or have the freedom to interpret religious teaching differently. So children, as it stated in fundamental right about the freedom of religion, any person can embrace another religion, exit from their religion, embrace another religion, or have the freedom to interpret religious teaching differently. To understand this point better, let us take the practice of untouchability. You might feel that you dislike this practice within Hinduism and therefore you want to try and reform it. However, if state power were in the hands of those Hindus who support untouchability, then do you think that you would have an easy task to try and change this? Even if you were part of dominant religious group, you might face a lot of resistance from fellow members of your community. These members who have control of state power might say that there is only one interpretation of Hinduism and that you do not have.
In the above storyboard, let us see what is stated, what is discussed. The answer given by the teacher here. In the storyboard, the students of government school ask their teacher to celebrate a big religious festival in the school premises. But teacher explained that government schools do not celebrate any religious festival because they cannot give importance to any one religion. In other words, teacher is trying to explain that celebration of religious festival in government organization means violating the aspect of federalism which is mentioned in our constitution. So this is explained in this storyboard. So in the above storyboard, the celebration of the religious festival within school would have been a violation of the government's policy of treating all religions equally. Government schools cannot promote any one religion either in the morning prayers or through religious celebration. This rule does not apply to private schools. Now let us see one of the question. Let us answer that, can there be different views within the same religion? Yes, there can be different views in the same religion. For example, in Hinduism, some people like to worship Lord Shiva while some other to Lord Vishnu. The Muslim community is also divided into Shias and Sunnis due to different beliefs. Children, now let us discuss one of the question. List the different types of religious practice that you find in your neighborhood. This could be different forms of prayer, worship of different gods, sacred sites, different kinds of religious music and singing, etc. Does this indicate freedom of religious practices? Now let us discuss this. Different types of religious practices that we found in our neighborhood are Hindus, Muslims, Sikhs, Christians, etc. Hindus go to the temple to worship God. They celebrate various festivals like Holi, Diwali, etc. They hymn bhajans, Ramayan and Gita. Muslims go to mosque to worship God Allah. They celebrate Eid, they recite Quran, elders go for their pilgrimage at Mecca. Sikhs celebrate Guru Nanak birthday and Guru Gobind Singh Jayanti. They go to Gurudwara to worship their God. Their holy book is Guru Granth Sahib. Christians go to church to pray. They celebrate Christmas.